about to begin. The awesomeness is about to start. I just started my fourth notebook.
Bishop Idika, this is our Saturday night broadcast, like we normally do have our services every Friday night, 8 p.m. Central, 9 Eastern, and on that's Friday and Saturday at the same time. Hallelujah. How do or how did people in the ancient world, how did they begin to communicate with the unseen world that is seen? Can anybody jump in here? How did people in ancient time begin to communicate with the supernatural, both demons, fallen angels, and divinity himself, the Most Holy Trinity? God the Father, the Most High God, Jesus our God and King, our Savior, and the Holy Spirit. After the human race performed an action of rebellion against themselves, because many a times what we think that it is just against God is also against ourselves, mostly, because what God asks us to do is mainly for our own benefits. How did humanity begin to get in touch with the supernatural? Because we are told that before we did things against ourselves and against Him, God used to come down and visit Adam and Eve at the cool of the evening. How did we begin to reach out and get the attention of the supernatural, whether good or bad? Can anybody help us tonight? Because that's where we are heading. It is what we call a sacrifice. Humans found out that sacrifice, the offering of an animal or food, or a human being, or a bird, or a drink, that's wine, attracted the unseen and seen forces. So, the first time we hear of this, we it wasn't from Adam and Eve, but from Abel and Cain. That's the first time we hear of human beings trying to attract the attention of God. We will have a week. We'll have a whole week whereby we will be dealing with sacrifices and altars. I hope, Jay, that you can text that or email that to me. Sacrifices and altars. I hope you're on the line tonight. Or Annie, if you are taking notes. Or ladder. Human beings began to attract the favor of, please, I do ask people to just stay in one place because we are picking up every little noise and move. It's almost like if you dial into my conference, it's like you are right here with me. I was very sensitive. I pick up everything. If you are just a little busy in your office, press mute. You will still be hearing me perfectly, but we will not hear the noise from your end. So that, because the noise will not allow others to hear me, neither will I be able to focus. I can decide to be muting people, but when there will be time that I ask questions for people to participate, then that's, I cannot mute people, then it's no longer enjoyable. That's the difference between the Aristotelian and Socratic method of imparting knowledge. What I do here is not merely academic exercise, is the impartation of power, revelation. Because many a time God will not want to move. He will not want to let go of his best. He will want you to apply an instruction. Instead of God turning 2 + 2 = 4, just giving you 4, he wants you to mix 2 + 2 yourself. You want you to participate in making 4 happen. So there are times that instead of God making food, instead of God making somebody knock on the door and give you a coupon to go to Walmart and pick up free stuff, instead somebody knock on your door and ask you whether you're ready for a high pay job that will give you more than enough. So which one is better? I would rather go for a great job or a great business that will give me more than enough than wait for an angel or wait for somebody to come and give me a little bit. See, that's what I'm doing does. What I'm doing give you more than enough. Some miracles give you just a little bit. I want you to go and check your Bible very well. And you will see that many a times where miracles happen, where God gave them meat to eat, that is, the wind of God drove quails into the camp of the Israelites in the wilderness. Well, they didn't have the equipment to hunt. manna, the food of angels, fell from heaven, and they pick it up and ate. They gather it. They gathered it. Why did God go to that level to give them food? It's because they were in a wilderness. They don't have the equipment to farm their land and make it fertile. And not only that, they were only passing through. But go and read the good news of the New Testament. And you will see that immediately they left the wilderness and they enter into the green land, the fertile land. The manna ceased. God stopped sending them food from heaven. God stopped sending meat to them. And they now have to farm. I want you to get the way it is done. If you want more than enough, it's going to come through these different ways. More than enough will come through your talent. That's why we are doing what we are doing this week, doing vengeance and revenge in order to set you free so that you can enjoy a more than enough life. I know that there are people for whom miracle of people giving them money, winning a lottery, giving them family treasures, what other people have worked for, that's what they are looking at. Or they are depending on another human being to do it for them. I'm serious. 80% might be pushed to say that of humanity sometimes think that way. And many a time do not get it that way. The gift of a human being opens doors for them. It is through your giftedness, your talent, your professional skills, your willingness to be in business, that God will give you the big money. Then, whatever God make other people give to you, or angels bring to you, is an addition to the more than enough you have, so that you have more than enough. That's how this thing is done. Human beings needed to attract the attention of the unseen forces and also of divinity himself, of God Almighty. And by instinct, because in every human being, if they look inward, it's a divine attribute. The desire to be connected with another human being, a champion, an idol, a force, something in here or out there that makes you feel complete. I want you to be aware. You read in Genesis of Abel and Cain bringing the sacrifices to God. One bring mediocre crops. That is Cain, just brought God anything. And Abel brought God the best among his flocks and offered it as a sacrifice. See, God is not really like interested in all those animal and food sacrifice. Maybe you guys did not know this. God was actually using those things to keep them focused on him. That's number one. So that they do not go to worship other things. And no, he wasn't interested in those things really. I'm serious. As I read through the Bible, I realized God was not really interested in all those animal sacrifice or food or drink offering. No. He allowed them to perform that. Number one, that was the level of their intellectual capacity. Number two, that was the level of the emotion and psychosocial response to life and to the invisible. Number three, God allowed human beings to perform those acts of services and worship called sacrifice at the altar in order to see how much you understand honor. Whether you are only coming to just give him what you don't want, because that's what we do. David says that he will never give God what he's not interested in anymore. So he can now, he's not interested in this goal. He has enough gold, so he can give God the rest. No. He gave God the best first, then the remaining is for him. So God is watching to see how your inside really respond to honor. I'm serious. That's all that God is looking at. That's why a lot of people, from the time they are born to the time they are dead, will never be wealthy. Why? Because they do not understand honor and law. The law of honor, or the honor of law, and the logic behind it in the supernatural and in the physical. That's why if I want to buy somebody thing, I go and look for the best and give to the person. I don't want to give you something that I don't want or something that didn't really cost me much, because that's how a lot of people, that's how they behave. And for sacrifices to really work, it must be placed on an altar. So tonight I'm talking about an altar. I'm not talking about the altar of God or sacrifices to God. But because we are dealing with vengeance and revenge, I am dealing with altars of darkness, altars and shrines of darkness, temples of darkness, churches of darkness, chapels of darkness, synagogues of darkness. We summarize all these things in altars and shrines of darkness. Now, when I will be dealing with sacrifice on the altar, it will be a week program for 7 days, from Monday to Saturday. No, to Sunday, yeah. From Monday to Sunday. That will be how many days? Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. 7 days, yes, I'm right. That's how long it's going to take me to deal with a summary of sacrifice on the altar, because it's a whole lot to be covered on that topic. I have to do that very quickly, because you need to know. You're entitled to supernatural knowledge, to supernatural revelation that birth miracles. Obedience to God's law brings about miracles. And that is the kind of miracle, whether God like it or not, he must do it. I'm serious here. Jesus never had a schedule for miracles. Never had a schedule for multiplying bread and fish, making money appear in the mouth of the fish that Peter caught. He has no schedule for healing sick people or casting out demons. People force him to do it. People of God, I want you to know this. Jay, if you're on the line, send me a short note on how to force God to do your will. Maybe we should deal with that tomorrow morning on our Sunday service. How to force God to do your will. Please, I need that immediately. Thank you. Jay, are you on the line tonight?
Yes, I
okay.
will.
Okay. Please email it to me because I need to prepare immediately. I need to prepare tonight. I need to spend some time before the altar to pray and prepare for that because we need to know this. It is you. Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you, my daughter. It is you that must force God to do your will. We read in Psalm 10, verse 1, during the midnight prayer, about how to stop God from standing and watching. How to make God not to hide himself. Go and look at the broadcast of last night. It's on YouTube. And it talks about, is it the one that says, talks about midnight prayer meeting. What was the title of that one? I have too much title in my mind. It is you who does it. And one of the ways that you make Jesus, the Holy Ghost, God the Father, how you can force them to do your will is understanding the law. What did Jesus say about specific things? What did the Holy Spirit say? What did God the Father say? What has angels spoken about different things? Those things become law. They become statutes. Laws, ordinances of the earth from heaven. And so whether Jesus likes it or he doesn't like it, he must do it. Because he's spoken it is the law. For example, you give your tithe. You force God, you drag God into a covenant that whether he likes it or not, he must do something for you. It's as simple as that. For the mere fact that Jesus was beaten, his back bloodied, his head bloodied, his hand destroyed. They destroyed his physical body. So that God can use the body of Jesus for supernatural medicine for us. That's become law. God, I refuse to die. The hospital said there is no cure, but I refuse to die. Why? Because you are my medicine. That's what the law says. And you must obey your own law and honor your own law. It's not that the law of America or the law of nations where when it affects those who wrote the law, those who are supposed to keep the law, they want to twitch it, bend it, turn it around, interpret it in a different way. That's why one of the most ridiculous things in America is it's not the lawyers of America or the judges of America. It's the Supreme Court of America. That's one of the most things that I don't like in this country. It's the way those at the very top interpret the law because they are voted in there as Republican Supreme Court judges or Democrat Supreme Court judges, and that doesn't make no sense. And I wonder how many more years we will survive as a nation with that kind of mentality. Because you are supposed to have judges who are not Republican or Democrat, who don't care about the interest of both, but the interest of the nation. And when you fail at the top of the law, at the Supreme Court, then the nation has failed as a nation. So let's look at where the failure begins. That's where it is. Altars are very important in calling up forces from heaven or from hell or from the water or from the earth. And there are different kinds of altars. And an altar well put together become activated. Why? Because there is a presence in that altar, permanent presence. For example, back here, where we have the altar for this ministry. This is not the altar for the ministry. This is the studio for the show that we are using for now. Where we will do the service tomorrow morning. I think it should be back there. I don't know yet. That is where all the email prayer requests, covenant requests, all kind of stuff, wish lists, they're all back there, not here. And there is a presence in that place. I know it. There's a presence there. There's also a presence here. When once it has been activated, I'm not here to tell you how we activate it. How many days it takes or how many months it takes to activate an altar. Because when once it is activated, it's on. There are times people walk to come and do things here, clean, other certain things here. People come in to help, sort things, package, all kind of stuff. And I'll tell them first, don't go near that site, please. Because I've experienced people walking in and trying to, oh, that's nice. You know, people walking, they don't even know what that is. They don't know it is an altar. They, oh, that's nice. Oh, and the person walked towards to go and look and touch, and boom! They're on the floor and that, yeah, help, help, help. What is in that place? So that's why when families are coming to visit, it is covered. There's a covering for it. And make sure the night before the arrival of visitors, it is covered. And then I ask the presence there, just take it easy. There is a different kind of altar from the altar of God. And that is demonic altars. Altars dedicated to fallen angels, to Baal, to Queen of the Coasts, to Lucifer himself, Son of the Morning, the former light bearer. There are altars dedicated to different demons depending on the different work they do. Because always remember that the one that leads the demons is always the Queen of the Coast or always fallen angels. A fallen angel make the move, demons then enter to do the job. So remember how I put it. Please write it down. Write it down for me. A fallen angel make the move, then demon enter to do the job. That's how you should put it. A fallen angel make the move. Jay, write it down for me. A fallen angel make the move, then demons enter and do the job. Number one, a fallen angel has a more concentrated energy and power than the demons. The demons are the torturers. They are the destroyers. They are the hinderers. And they are the killers. They are the foot soldiers, nasty, nasty, nasty people. They are ghetto bastards. You can send them to work anywhere, they don't care. Why? Because they've sworn loyalty to Satan. There are people, altars are always set up by humans, not by demons, not by fallen angels. They don't set up altars. It's always humans. Wicked and evil altars could be set up in the open place. They are set up for particular demons or particular fallen angels or for Baal or for Queen of the Coast or for Lucifer himself. Altars are set up for this group. They are not set up for humans. Altars are always for the supernatural beings. Excuse me. You do not set up altars for a human being. In some cultures, except it's a human being that has qualified to become, who have passed into the other side, whether heaven or hell. In some cultures, they don't talk about heaven and hell. They talk about the world of the ancestors. And then people saw them as sons and daughters of the divine. Whatever they mean by that. And so they set up altars for those kind of people. An altar is where you offer prayers, sacrifices, you offer money, you offer alcohol, you offer different kind of wine, you offer gifts of different kinds. That is also where you come to bow and sometimes to stay in his front, not at his back, to wait, to be possessed and taken over by a demon. Because fallen angels do not take possession of people's bodies. They influences your body, your mind, your spirit. They influences it, but they do not live in you. The one that does the job of living inside and taking control are the demons. Hallelujah. Before someone qualified to be a witch doctor, a big room, is activated with an altar. An altar might not be a standing altar. Some altars are ground altars. But there will always be a lantern, a candle lit all the time, or a lantern that is on all the time, or electric light. Sometimes it is a green bulb. Sometimes it's a red bulb, especially a red bulb. If it is an electric light that is always on 24/7. Except in places where there is not constant light, then you don't have that. And then they will turn on the lantern. Why? It is to tell you that something lives there. There's something that is in that place. There are altars that could be erected in the bush, in the forest, near the water. Some are erected during a particular ceremony, and after the ceremony, it is dismantled, and the things for that altar is carried by somebody who is the priest or priestess of that demon. And the person takes it back and keeps it in a place where nobody touches it. everything that is used for altar is kept sacred. It's not a joke. That's why when we start churches all over the world, we'll make sure every church is activated for Jesus until his presence comes upon that building. It can never be used for worship, because until his presence appears there and remains there permanently, miracles, signs and wonders will never be an ongoing thing in that place. It must be an ongoing thing because his presence is activated. Ladri just set up a very beautiful and big altar. And picture of mine is there. And I started activating it. I've not finished. Looks really nice, smells good. Beverly has one, but I don't know how she's using it now. I think if she get this video, you need to give me a call. Let me know how your altar is working. All of you who have altar from me or who want to have an altar from me, call me and I will tell you how and what it will cost you, what I will send to you, things like that. And then I will tell you how long it's going to take me to activate it. And the day I tell you it's activated, when you go there, just be prepared to be slain or to go into a trance or vision just like that. That's how you know. Listen, it's nothing like you just come and pray and walk away now. Real altar, you enter there, you know that there's something there. There's a presence, there's an angel in that place. There are wicked altars set up by wicked people in forests, somewhere in the city. And they alone knows. In somebody's house, some people, if they do not want to set up a wicked altar in their home, they go to a hotel where they spend a weekend or they spend a week and they erect an altar and do what they are doing. They are calling somebody. They offer a simple sacrifice. Depending on the kind of sacrifices they want to do will also define where the altar is set up. In ancient Jewish setup or Jewish practices, there were altars in the temples, in the synagogue and all of that. Different altars for different things, for different celebration and different rituals. There is no lodge without an altar. Many a time, what we call an altar in our churches is just a shack. There's nothing there. There's nothing there, absolutely. No power. Angels are not present. The power of Jesus is not there. His presence is not there. The glory of God the Father is not there. No revelation, no knowledge, no power, nothing. Just politics, power, and money. I love apple juice a lot. So good. Love it. There are people who set up wicked altars and shrines in their homes. The most activated ones are the ones that Luciferians, those who worship Lucifer, and Satanists set up, and witch doctors, and voodoo priests, shamans, medicine men who combine the practice of medicine with the practice of magic and witchcraft. The same thing. Those are very active ones. The higher and the more loyal you are to a particular demon, the more you worship, everyday worship, sometimes twice or thrice a day, sometimes you have certain days of the week that you give to that deity, the more activated an altar is. There are people who have altars in their home to protect their marriages, protect their businesses, or protect their children. But those are not the kind that I'm talking about. I'm talking about those who have altars where they go to call you, where they go to offer money, blood, and then they call you. There are altars that there are no physical things you see, but a tree. And a particular tree has been selected at the back of a house of one of the family members where they go to pour drink, to offer kola nuts, or to offer food, or to offer money. So you come there, you see money there. You pick that money, you're in trouble. There are some altars you find by the river. Whereby they will take a sheep, a cow, that's a lamb, a cow, chicken, goat, and they go there and offer, but they do not kill the animal. They just leave the, they just let the animals wander around there. You go and get that animal and take it home and eat it, you die. Seriously. Go and try it and tell me that you are a scientist, that nothing will happen to you. This is just mere talk. There's nothing there. Go and eat it and see. Because I've seen people who have tried to be scientists and they ate those things and they grew fat and they died. There were soldiers who were told not to shoot any chicken they found in a particular city. If you see chicken wandering about, don't shoot them. You see goats or lambs wandering about in the field or in the bushes, don't shoot them. Leave them alone. And they are, it doesn't matter. Ah, we are soldiers. They had on it. They shot one, took it back, went and cooked it, and all of them died the next morning. Because those animals doesn't belong to you. They belong to a spirit being. A deity, unclean spirit owns them. There are altars and shrines that are calling your names, that are shouting your name and your family name. There are wicked altars that is saying, at any time you're going to get a job, that altar shout no. At any time you're about to study in a marriage, that altar say no. At any time your children are about to receive scholarship, that altar shout no. There are some altars of no that have been set up against some people. I'm serious, some shrines and altars. And they have been activated against somebody. A particular altar could be set up against a particular person. And you may not know this. And you as a born-again Christian, yeah, I have Jesus, I have the Holy Ghost. But you have to be aware of what people do in darkness. That's why sometimes you see Christians, they are healthy, and one day you just say, the person just collapsed, died. Boah. The person was just driving, and then a semi truck came from nowhere, hit the person, boom, the person died on the spot. And you say, this was a holy person, very faithful unto the Lord. Why? The person did not pay attention to warfare. Because God will show you a sign that somebody is doing some warfare against you. And that you should pick the person up and deal with them. You should destroy altars. Last night when we finished the midnight prayer, I was praying with a sister and altars were being broken. It was, oh my gosh. It was great. When I see people receive deliverance, just make me, just, it's a thrill. when you hear demons revealing what they've been doing in that person's life. An altar and a shrine could be the reason why you are not getting any money. An altar could be the reason why, if you're a man, you can never make any woman pregnant, even though the doctors say you are fine. If you're a woman, an altar and a shrine could be the reason you'll never get pregnant. You'll never be able to carry a baby in your womb. There is an altar. You'll never be able to be favored. An altar of hatred so that people hate you just by hearing your name and seeing your face, they don't like you. Everybody else are loved. They are taken care of and not you. An altar could be set up for sickness, for poverty, for different things. And many a times we don't know, except the Holy Spirit begin to reveal. Because many a time we think that by being born again and spirit-filled, that solves the problem. The point is, the Holy Spirit has to give you instruction as to what is behind the scene, and then you deal with it. Because Jesus doesn't deal with it, you deal with it. Except if an active glory of God is in motion, then things are revealed and destroyed of his own. But where that is not, then God give word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discernment of spirit, for you to know sometimes even the name of the forces behind it. And then when once you call them, you expose them, is up. And then you call fire to burn them, to burn such an altar. And what you say physically here in America, destroy a shrine or an altar in India, in Africa, in Russia, in China, in Germany, in Italy, in Spain, in Norway, in Switzerland, anywhere in the world. Because our words are not A, our words are things. It's spirit. Jesus said, the word I've spoken to you, they are spirit and they are life. Tonight, I want to ask you to do something. I want to ask you to begin to pray and do vengeance against those who have set up evil and wicked altars and shrines against you. Unmute your phone and begin to pray aloud. And I want you to send fire to every wicked altar, every wicked shrine that is speaking against you. Send the fire of the Holy Ghost to destroy such, and let your freedom be assured forever, so that you don't mess up again. There are altars that are set up for you to live in confusion and to be messed up forever so that you keep making mistakes. There's an altar that is turning it on. So you have to turn it off. Begin to pray. Come on, begin to pray and let's go. Let's get out of here. Begin to pray. Begin to pray. Send fire. Send fire to altars and to shrines that are speaking against you. Destroy them. Send the fire of the Holy Ghost. I know that many of you do not know how to do these things. Wherever you are, I'm not gonna do it for you. You're gonna pray and send Holy Ghost fire to destroy every shrine and every altar that we set up against you, that has been activated against you. Destroy it so that you'll be free. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Anywhere altars are gathering, Holy Ghost fire, destroy them. Anywhere shrines are gathering, Holy Ghost fire, destroy them. Anywhere Satan has gathered, Holy Ghost fire, destroy them. Every altar and every shrine set up against you, wicked and evil altars, be broken down. I send fire of the Holy Ghost to destroy wicked altars and shrines against your life in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Every altar and shrine that is turning on demonic forces against your life, that is controlling your life and destiny, I command them be broken in the name of Jesus. Fire! 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 Hallelujah. She bola lo she tatli ba woke tele bele kotando. Eye kende ba lo she kanda la ba lo ke shinda. Mampo kotele. Lukantu ba lo sente. Mula kumpantu la bu kantali sente. In Jesus' mighty name. Altars and shrine that has been attracting you to wicked people, wicked marriages, wicked relationship, I send fire to burn them tonight. Altars that are keeping you from your destiny, be broken in the name of Jesus. I break you. Altars and shrine of sickness, mental sickness and all kind of sickness, I break you in Jesus' name. Altars and shrine that is stopping you from going to the next level, I break them in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Tomorrow morning, we are meeting by 8 o'clock Central in the morning. That's 9 a.m. Eastern. And we will be dealing with some more issues. We will bring the we'll bring the 2 days of vengeance. We'll bring it to an end. There will be so many miracles that we shall be seeing from what has happened the last 2 weeks and this week. I want to thank you for joining me to do this, and I wish you a very wonderful weekend. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.